Before we begin our service this morning, I'm going to light our first Advent candle. And please join in with the responses after each section that I pray. Heavenly Father, you have created a universe of light. Forgive us when we return to darkness. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are the light of the world. Cleanse and heal our blinded sight. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Holy Spirit, you give us light in our hearts. Renew us in faith and love. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. So good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Advent service on Sunday, the 28th of November. Firstly, let me apologise for continuing to record services from home lately. It's because the church has been so busy that I've been unable to get in to record at a suitable time. But I do hope that you're enjoying our services just the same. This week, the Christmas tree and the stable scene have been put up by Graham Deal, Chris Davis, and a team of people. And so the church looks wonderful as we prepare to welcome you and our visitors over the Advent and Christmas season. There are also amazing Christmas arrangements in place thanks to Linda Gilby and her team of flower arrangers. I'm sure you'll join with me in thanking everyone who has been involved in preparing the church for Christmas. There are still a few Christchurch Christmas cards that need delivering. If you are able and if you have time, that would be fabulous. There's not many roads to do now. And my thanks to all the people who have been out delivering cards so faithfully this year. We have a booklet that's just arrived called At the Heart of Christmas. It's written by various people, but the main authors are Archbishop Justin Welby and also our former bishop, Stephen Cottrell, who is now Archbishop of York. And there's several others who have contributed to this booklet as well. It contains stories and meditations for 12 days beginning on Christmas Eve. So do collect one or ask for a copy to be delivered if you are unable to collect it. The new Christmas Hope magazine has arrived, and once again, do ask for that to be delivered if you are unable to get to the church. But also, if you do come to church, please take copies of these for your neighbours, your friends, your family. We've got about 300 copies, so let's get them out there. It's full of stories about Christians and Christian events. It's a lovely magazine. We also, in the church, have some Christmas cards. I've actually been to Mulberry House and collected some more cards. These cards, there's 10 cards in a pack, and they are just £2 each for 10 cards. And if you would like any of these, you can ask for some to be delivered or do come in and pick up the cards if you have time. They're going to a good cause, Mulberry House, which is a Christian conference centre at Ongar. As you know, we have been focusing this year on doing church in a more eco-friendly way. So we have a single Christmas card available in the church for you to sign. Probably we'll need to sign on a piece of paper because there's quite a lot of us, but the card will be displayed and you can signed that one card for all your friends in Christchurch if you want to do that. So that will be instead of sending lots of cards, so lots of paper would be saved by you doing that. And we just ask for a donation to go to an eco-friendly charity, and we'll decide that after Christmas. So that's all the notices. So let's just be quiet for a moment, shall we? And as we prepare ourselves to worship. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, direct our thoughts, teach us to pray, lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so we come to our confession. Is there something you want to say sorry to God for? Something you said or did this week that you now regret? Something you left undone and you really wish you had done it? Let's just take a moment, shall we, to bring those things before the Lord. Lord Jesus Christ, we confess we have failed you, as did your first disciples. We ask for your mercy and your help. Most merciful God, we confess to you before the whole company of heaven and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. Forgive us our sins, heal us by your Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ. Amen. Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be destroyed, forgive us our sins, open our eyes to God's truth, strengthen us to do God's will, and give us the joy of his kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we're going to have our Bible reading, after which Catherine Benbow will be preaching.
Today's Old Testament reading is Psalm 25, 1 to 9. In you, Lord, my God, I put my trust. I trust in you. Do not let me put to shame, or let my enemies triumph over me. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame, but shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord, teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Saviour, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from old. Do not remember the sins of my youth, and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right, and teaches them his way. Today's New Testament reading is Luke 21, verses 25 to 36. There will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity to the roaring and tossing of the sea. People will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world. The heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, stand up, lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. He told them in this parable, look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Be careful, or your hearts will be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the anxieties of life, and that day will close on you suddenly like a trap. For it will come on all those who live on the face of the whole earth. Be always on the watch, and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen, and that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today is Advent Sunday, the first Sunday of Advent, the start of a four-week period that leads to Christmas. But Advent Sunday is more than this. It is regarded as the beginning of the Christian year, and so it is the start of the church's year. You may know this already, but my sister was surprised to find this out, which reminded me that not everyone in the church does know. And it is, I think, unlikely that many people outside the church know this. Of course, people do know about Advent. There are Advent calendars around, although many of these start on the 1st of December and are filled with chocolate or even drink or perfume. And you see Advent crowns and wreaths in doorways and windows, whether the people who put them up come to church or not. And yes, today being the start of Advent, you don't have to wait until the 1st of December to get that Advent crown out. But hang on a minute. Why is it Advent Sunday when it's still November? Because there have to be four Sundays in Advent. And when Christmas Day falls on a Saturday or a Sunday, these Sundays cannot all be in December. Count it out if you don't believe me. And yes, we all get caught out, even in church. Advent was originally established as the equivalent to Lent, the period before Easter. At Easter, the church celebrated the resurrection, Jesus Christ rising from the dead. And new Christians would be baptized on that day, and they would have spent Lent in preparation for this. Advent became the six-week period of preparation before another major Christian festival, originally what we now call Epiphany, celebrating the visit of the three wise men, or kings, when Jesus was hailed as king not just of the Jews, but of the whole world. Gradually, however, the emphasis shifted from Epiphany to the celebration of Christ's birth itself, which would, over many years, become the Christmas we're now used to. And as Christmas is 2 weeks earlier than Epiphany, Advent became the four-week period that we have today. So why Advent? It's from the Latin Adventus, which means coming. And there's actually a triple meaning at play here. Because Advent might firstly be the period before Christmas, and we are looking forward to this in the sense of the festival coming and getting ready for it. I realise that not everyone enjoys the festivities. But the events that we call Christmas happened a long time ago. So we're not just looking forward to a roast turkey or a nut roast. We are, in fact, looking back approximately 2,000 years. And so we hear or sing carols, listen to readings about a baby, about shepherds and about angels. We exchange presents, have a good time, and then most of us move on with our lives. But just listening to the music or watching a nativity play and then moving on is to miss the point entirely. Because the second part of the triple meaning I mentioned involves us still looking forward. And in order to look forward in this second sense, We have to start with looking back, not just to the events in Bethlehem, but even further, back into what we call the Old Testament, back to the dawn of time, to creation itself. When the world was created, God saw that it was good. We only have to look around now to see that everything is not good. And all through the Old Testament, people who we now call prophets would look around in their time, see what was wrong, point out what needed to be put right. Sometimes they were listened to, often they were not. But to put everything right required a new creation, a new beginning. And the prophets began to look forward to when this would be. And we'll hear from some of them. Isaiah, for example, "Unto us a child is born." Micah, "Bethlehem, from you shall come a saviour." And others as we go on into Advent. And this new creation started when the baby, we know to be Jesus Christ, was born in Bethlehem. So having looked back to the beginning, we look forward with the prophets to the birth of the Messiah, the Saviour, the Prince of Peace. And we can then pause a moment because we've arrived at the same point that our festivities are about, Christ born in Bethlehem. So we can hear about the baby, the shepherd, and the angels. Except, of course, that's not what we've heard in our readings today. So we have to look forward in the third meaning of Advent. And this is very much looking forward. Although, again, we have to look back to what Jesus is saying here. Jesus and his disciples are in the temple in Jerusalem. And they and others have been listening to him, talking with him, arguing with him, asking questions, and actually, in this case, seeking clarification, although it doesn't sound much like clarification here. A few days before, Jesus had been welcomed into Jerusalem as king, greeted by shouts of "Hosanna!" Salvation. And he'd gone straight into the temple and driven out the money changers and anyone else doing business there with the words, "My house will be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." He's then been in the temple every day, surrounded by large numbers of people who are hanging on to his every word. And he's had plenty to say, teaching the people and proclaiming the good news, as Luke puts it. And just before the passage today, he's issued a warning. Some of his disciples had been remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God. And Jesus had said, "As for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down." And the temple was a glorious building, the second temple on the site. The first, built by King Solomon, was destroyed when Jerusalem had fallen to the Babylonians. It was rebuilt after the Israelites were allowed home, 500 years before our reading. But national memories run deep. Any perceived threat to the temple wasn't taken lightly. In fact, the temple had been badly damaged again when Alexander the Great's army had invaded 200 years before. And at the time that Jesus is speaking, it's still undergoing repairs and renovation. Luke's gospel may have been written after AD 70, when Jerusalem was indeed destroyed again, this time by the Romans, with the temple razed to the ground and never rebuilt. In which case, Luke knows what he's talking about, at least in a physical sense. But as I said, national memories run deep, and anyone listening to the words in our reading would understand. The temple was a sacred space, the sacred space, and now there was a threat to both it and Jerusalem. Jesus, of course, really knows what he's talking about, because he is not just the man recently welcomed into the city as king. He really is the king, the Messiah, God the Saviour, the one in whom his listeners, indeed all people, should put their trust. And And now Jesus is talking to some of his disciples. We don't know how many, but this conversation is heard and overheard. And we know that some of the words spoken during this period will be used, or rather misused, in evidence at Jesus' trial in a few days' time. Matthew reports that he said, "Two witnesses came forward and declared, 'This fellow said, I'm able to destroy the temple of God and build it in 3 days.'" And John writes, Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it up again in 3 days." So Luke's account, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another, every one of them will be thrown down, is seen as a threat. And those disciples with him are naturally concerned and anxious. They need to know, when is all this going to happen? And people ever since have wondered. AD 70 would come and go. Jerusalem was indeed destroyed. The temple was demolished and looted. People scattered. As Jesus says in our reading today, nations will be in anguish and perplexity. But although the events of AD 70 must have seemed like the end of the world to those in Jerusalem, the world clearly didn't end. And indeed, the world still exists 2,000 years later, despite everything that has happened since and everything that is still happening. War, fear, injustice, oppression, pandemics, volcanoes, earthquakes, global warming. So what was Jesus saying? And what does it mean to us now? We are still looking forward to what is often called the second coming, to when God will finish the new creation that started that first Christmas. And there will indeed be a new heaven and a new earth. At that time, they will see the Son of Man, that's Jesus, coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, stand and lift your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. But whereas with the first two meanings of Advent, we end up in Bethlehem with the baby, the shepherds and the angels, we have no time frame for the events Jesus describes in our reading. Instead, we're told, "Be careful, or your hearts will be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness and the anxieties of life. And that day will close on you suddenly like a trap." In other words, don't just move on without a thought, but live as followers of Jesus Christ, with his promise that heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. So what about Advent? We look forward to Christmas 2021. We look back to that first Christmas when Jesus was born in Bethlehem. And we continue to look forward to the day when Jesus will indeed be acknowledged as King of the nations, to the new heaven and the new earth. And as we go forward into the new year, we need to put our trust in God, to follow him and to live as his people. In you, Lord my God, I put my trust. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Saviour, and my hope is in you all the day long. Amen. And now we have a worship song that sums up Advent. Lift up your heads to the coming King. Lift up your heads to the coming King.
Thank you very much, Catherine. And isn't that a lovely worship song? As Advent Sunday, we are reminded to lift up our heads, not just to the coming baby king, but to King Jesus when he returns. So we're now going to affirm our faith together. If you would like to, please stand. We believe and trust in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And so we come to our time of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this Advent and Christmas season, as we look forward to rejoicing in your birth and also look forward to your return at the end of time. Thank you that as we prepare for Christmas, we are reminded of how busy Mary and Joseph must have been as they prepared to journey to Bethlehem, and also had the added concern of preparing for your birth. Please help us not to get so caught up in all the preparations and activity of this season that we forget to focus on you, the heart of Christmas. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Approximately 383,000 babies are born every day. Many are cherished and loved, but sadly many will experience neglect, abuse, poverty and hunger. Lord, you came into the world for each of these babies born today and every day. For the most vulnerable who need love, care, support and protection, Lord, we pray you will give us insight as to how we can each help bring greater justice and security for the most vulnerable. We pray especially for girls who are not valued in many countries, for those who are sold into marriage at a young age, those who are forcibly held down to undergo FGM. And for both boys and girls who are trafficked into prostitution. Lord, we feel helpless when we hear about these situations, but please remind us to pray without ceasing for vulnerable children and young people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. During this busy season, we pray for our churches as they prepare to welcome unusually high numbers of visitors. We pray for all those in our team who are working so hard to prepare the churches and to cover the high number of services. Jesus took his disciples away for a while to rest with him. And we pray that in the busyness of this season, we will all find the time to stop, to reflect, and to rest in you, to receive spiritual refreshment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We now pray for those who are on our notice sheet, who are sick, and also those who are known personally to us who need our prayers at this time. Let's also bring before God those who are lonely, those who are depressed, the disappointed, and for those with mental health problems. Please pray quietly in your hearts or name them out loud. Lord, as we bring those we love before your throne of grace, we ask for your healing on all those who are sick or in need of your loving arms around them today. And now we pray for those who are recently bereaved. We pray especially for the families of Jim Poynter, Gordon Eames, and Ernest Satchell, whose funeral is on Tuesday. Father God, please comfort the families of these loved ones and bring them to your eternal glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, we pray for ourselves. Lord, thank you that you love each one of us beyond our imagining. And thank you that whatever our life experience or whatever others may say about us, we are precious to you. Lord, please help us to grow closer to you day by day and to fulfill the purposes you have for each one of us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now let's say the Lord's Prayer together. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now the collect for the first Sunday of Advent. Almighty God, as your kingdom dawns, turn us from the darkness of sin to the light of holiness, that we may be ready to meet you in our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we come to our final notices, which I just have one. And that is to remind you that it's our Advent carol service this evening at 5 p.m. So do come along if you have time. The choir from Butsbury Junior School will be singing, and it's going to be lovely. We're now going to hear our final song of worship, Christ Be Our Light. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light upon our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all people in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So whatever you're doing for the rest of the day, I do hope that you have a blessed day, and thank you for joining us this morning. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and all those you love this day and forevermore. Amen. So on this Advent Sunday, let's go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.